So the bottom line is, doctors are pretty sure that I've got a cancerous growth on my pancreas. So at this point in the video, I was going to be talking to you from home after being home for a week. But last night we had a bit of an emergency and a pretty massive bleed into my drain site. So we had to call an ambulance and now I'm back in hospital. So I'll resume this video once I'm back home again. Okay, so I'm back home again. I had planned to record this video after being at home from hospital for a week, but on that morning we had a bit of an emergency and had to go back into hospital. More about that soon. Back on the 1st of April this year, I recorded a video that I titled, "I've Got Cancer," because doctors had found a growth on my pancreas, and I just wanted to let everyone know what was going on and to thank some people. If you haven't seen that video, go back and check it out. This video is a bit of an update. One of our friends commented on that first video that they couldn't wait for a follow-up that we titled Kicking Cancer's Ass. So thank you for that. That's what this video is. It's a follow-up and we're pretty much kicked its ass. Doctors say that they got all the cancer out where they had to slice the pancreas. So I've lost about a third of my pancreas, but where they cut, the cancer hadn't reached yet. So doctors are pretty confident that they've got all the cancer out, but in a few weeks I'll be starting chemotherapy just to make sure that there was nothing left behind. So in this video, just a quick update, I suppose, to let you know what happened. When I woke up in intensive care after the operation, which went for about almost 10 hours, they say, one of the first things that I heard was that the operation was a success. And I thought, you beauty, I'll be home in 2 or 3 weeks. However, I was in hospital for 8 weeks. So even though the operation itself was a success, there were quite a few setbacks along the way. Some were pretty major, some just not so. The first one was day one in intensive care. I had a nasal gastric tube through my nose into my stomach that was supposed to stop me from vomiting, but I managed to vomit that tube up. So I was stuck with this tube in my nose, out my mouth, until the nurses could get onto the surgeons to work out what to do. Luckily, they were able to take it out. The next setback I had was to do with the central line. When you have major surgery, they'll put in a line in through your neck that goes deep down into your body so that they could administer drugs and whatever else they need to do. But for me, it didn't really work. Normally it would stay in, and once you're in the ward, the nurses can use that as well. But it didn't really work properly, so it was taken out, and then they had a lot of trouble with it still bleeding. They tried stitching it up, they tried lots of dressing, but for a long time it would just keep bleeding. One day I wake up, this was back in the ward, I wake up to find my pillow, my sheets, me, just covered in blood. I'd started to bleed out through the neck in my sleep, even though there was lots of dressing on there. So an emergency was called. I'd gone into shock, so I had fever, high heart rate, heavy breathing, all that sort of thing. So what they had to do to stop the bleeding, good old-fashioned way, nurses sticking the finger in the neck. That took about 4 hours of them taking turns with the finger in my neck to stop the bleeding, while other experts worked on getting my heart rate and breathing and everything back down to normal. And in my head, I felt like I was in a war zone. But in the big scheme of things, that wasn't a big setback. It was one night, and didn't really impact my recovery. What did impact my recovery, when doctors thought I was good to go with some solid food, they soon discovered that there was a small leak between where they'd rejoined my bowel to my stomach, and food was leaking, basically. So then that was back to clear, not much at all. I was limited to sucking on ice, very limited fluids for a couple of weeks, while they hoped that that would heal itself. Eventually, I was able to go back onto solid foods. The other problem we had, and probably the biggest setbacks, was collections, where you rejoin organs. So they've had to rejoin my stomach to my bowel to the bile duct. You get collections of fluid, or sometimes a pus. So extra drain tubes had to be put in to drain that fluid, and then one of those collections actually became infected, which was causing high heart rate, fevers, and basically that's what kept me in hospital for as long as it did. But with antibiotics, and some very specialised antibiotics, we got on top of that. Eventually, after 8 weeks, I was allowed to go home. And when I got home, I just had no energy at all. I had planned to record a video like this, like as soon as I got home, but with just no energy to do anything, I then decided I'd leave that for a week. So I edited the little montage you saw at the start of this video from videos that my wife had taken. And the next day we're going to record this video. But early that morning, because I still had a drain tube in, I've gone to go to bed and realised that drain bag was full of blood. So we had to call an ambulance back to hospital, 4 days, and then back home again. But during that 4 days, I had a procedure to stop the bleeding, and then they had me back on clear fluids again, so I didn't have anything to eat that whole time. The only thing I'd been having was nutrition through a tube from a drip, goes direct into my small intestine, and that allows that allowed the stomach to rest. When I first came home, I still had drain tube in, as I said, and that filled with blood, so there was a problem there, and that's why we had to call an ambulance and get back to hospital. Now that I'm back home again for the second time, that drain tube's gone. So all I've got is the tube for the feet. I did have nurses coming out every day to help with the drain tube, but now that that's gone, I'm just going to my GP every second day to get some dressings looked at. So that's basically where I'm at. I've got an appointment on the 24th of June this month with an oncologist where we'll look at starting chemotherapy. And from what the surgeons have been telling me, chemotherapy could be up to 6 months. Now at this stage I don't know how I'll react to that, whether I'll lose my hair, whether I'll be sick, I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. But in the meantime, that's where I'm up to. The other reason for making this video is just to thank so many people. Everyone who commented on social media, everyone who called me, everyone who visited, everyone who sent cards and flowers and everything else, thank you so much. Thank you to friends and family that have helped out with meals. And of course, especially thank you to my wife Mandy and the kids, Josh, Brad and Carla, for being so strong and brave. I could not have got through this without you. So thanks again, everyone. Hopefully I'm well enough to get out and see some people soon. And hopefully I can post some more videos and updates soon as well. Thanks for watching. Thanks for your support. Thanks also to Mandy's employer and my employer, who've made things a lot easier as well. Thanks to everybody. Who else do I want to thank? Nurses in the hospital do an awesome job. And it breaks your heart sometimes when you see people come in to visit patients and their Uncle Fester isn't lying straight and they just start yelling at the nurses and they've got no idea at the hard work the nurses put in. Nurses are awesome. Of course, doctors and everyone else in the hospital too are fantastic. Anyway, I've waffled on for long enough. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks.